said love, love comes naturally.
Yeah. Everybody, comes naturally. Thank you for being here. It is June. So happy June, everybody. And June is a wonderful month for me because it is my birthday month. Actually, in 2 days, I will be celebrating my birthday. As probably most of you know, if you've heard me speak, I do not count the years anymore. I let go of that several years ago. I found it was just kind of counterproductive, and it was my guidance to not do that anymore. And I try not to think about the years. In fact, if the idea of the years comes into my mind, I note it and gently try to move to other thoughts. So if one was to ask me how old I am going to become, I would say I am going to become an eternal, infinite expression of the divine in form. No years represent that. That's eternal. That is beyond years. And that is my guidance. And that is what I am choosing to identify with. I like to say that I am not aging. I am youthing. So you can all embrace youthing as well. Youthing sounds so much more fun than aging. Okay, there is a quote in A Course in Miracles that says, "Is it not madness to think of life as being born, aging, losing vitality, and dying in the end?" So all those things are actually madness. Aging is actually madness. In other words, insanity. Aging is insanity. So why would I want to do something that A Course in Miracles has identified as insane? I certainly do not want to do that. So I am not aging. I am youthing. And it is something we all can do. Another place in A Course in Miracles, it says, "The world is not left by death, but by truth." So there's a big belief system in the world that we will leave the world and possibly re-enter the spiritual realm or heaven by going through this experience that we call dying. And most people sort of think of that as a comforting idea, that the trials and tribulations of earthly life are infinite, that eventually we will reunite with our spiritual selves. The bad news is that's not true. The world's not left that way. The world's left through truth, not by dying. Dying probably just switches you to another manifestation that's very similar to this manifestation. Even if not in form, it will be similar in content. So just remember that. We don't leave this world by going through a dying experience. We leave this world by truth, by embracing truth. And the truth is we are eternal, infinite expressions of the divine. That is the truth. And that is what will cause us to leave manifestation realm with all its problems. So I'm embracing that now. Now, even though I don't count the years, I still really do like to celebrate my birthday. It's my special day, and I celebrate it, and I rejoice, as A Course in Miracles says. I rejoice. Rejoice is a great word because it's re and joy. In other words, we are returning to joy. Joy is our natural state, and so when we rejoice, we return to our natural state of, you know, joy is beyond mere happiness. It's something at a whole exponential level above happiness. So we rejoice, and I am choosing rejoicing and celebrating on my birthday. Course in Miracles says, "Why are you not rejoicing? You are free of pain and sickness, misery and loss, and all effects of hatred and attack." Okay, so A Course in Miracles asks us lots of questions. Most of us consider those questions rhetorical questions, in other words, questions that are just there for a statement's sake, and we don't think about answering them. But a certain discipline that I have embraced, and I challenge you to embrace, is when A Course in Miracles asks you a rhetorical question, answer it. Answer all the rhetorical questions in A Course in Miracles. Why are you not rejoicing? No good reason. No good reason. In other words, I am going to rejoice, and I'm going to use every opportunity that I can to rejoice, and birthday is a great opportunity to rejoice. It's my special day, and I have a lot to rejoice. I have a lot to celebrate. You know, I think about the past year and what's happened to me and to the world. I got a lot. We all got a lot to celebrate and to rejoice. For me, personally, for one, I survived a fairly serious case of COVID-19. On January 6th, as many of you know, I was told by doctors that I was not expected to live. You know, and it seems kind of silly now, and you kind of can laugh at it, but, you know, it was a very serious thing at the time, and I was in the emergency room at Kaiser in San Francisco, and to have two doctors really try to get me to realize that they thought I was probably going to die, and that the only chance of survival I had would be to be admitted to the hospital, to agree to be put on a ventilator right there while I was in the emergency room, and to agree right there while I was in the emergency room that it was okay for them to put me on remdesivir. I mean, that was a pretty serious thing. And A Course in Miracles says, sickness is a way of demonstrating that you can be hurt. It is a witness to your frailty, your vulnerability, and your extreme need to depend on external guidance. So when we're ill, we identify with this extreme need to be looking for external guidance. And the external guidance that I was offered was to check into the hospital and to agree to be put on these protocols that have a very low survival rate. You know, and I am celebrating and I am rejoicing that I had the knowledge and the connection to the Holy Spirit to know that I did not want to do that, that that is not what the Holy Spirit wanted me to do. And even though I was not well, and when you're not well, we have this extreme need, we believe, to depend on external guidance. And even though that was all there, I was able to say no to that external guidance. I was able to reject the advice of the doctors who tried very, very hard to convince me to check into the hospital and to impress upon me how serious and dire my situation was. And I didn't check into the hospital. I went home, came to my home, and I did my alternative protocol, not a protocol that they would have approved. In fact, they told me it wouldn't do any good. But I did my protocol, I did my supplements, I did my alternative medicine. And within 2 days, I felt I was better. As I've said, the first indication that I was getting better was I felt hungry. And I had not felt hungry for about a week or more. And so just the fact that I felt hungry made me realize that I must be getting better. My body was functioning. I had hunger again. 3 days after that incident, I led the Sunday gathering right here at Zoom. You know, I was not looking too good, and I had oxygen tubes in my nose, but I was functioning and leading the Sunday gathering, and, you know, within a very short time, I was much better. It took a while to really, you know, get totally back to my happy, strong self, but I got better, and I'm going to celebrate that and rejoice that. With that, and I'm really going to celebrate and rejoice that I knew not to listen to the external guidance, even though there's a strong tendency to do that in the world. So I got my internal guidance, and my internal guidance, I believe, saved my life. I mean, literally, I think it saved my body's life. Now, my eternal life was never threatened. I was always eternally safe. But I'm happy that my body's life was saved. I'm happy to still be here. I'm happy to be talking today. I'm happy to be planning a little 3-day trip to celebrate my birthday coming up. And I'm happy for a lot of other things too. I'm celebrating the return of a lot of normalcy to our culture and our society. And the city that I live in, San Francisco, you know, for one, I can eat indoors again. You know, for a long time, I could not eat indoors. But, you know, that has all been lifted, and people are eating indoors, and the restaurants are functioning again and getting busier and busier. I see fewer and fewer people wearing masks. And I like that because I like to see faces and I like to smile at people and I like to have them smile back at me. I like to be able to see it. I think it's really important psychologically for the psychological health of humans to be able to see the facial expressions of people and to be able to see smiles. An interesting statistic, maybe you know this, maybe you don't, is that last weekend, Memorial Day weekend, Americans returned to the movie theaters in record numbers. They went to see Top Gun Maverick. And Top Gun Maverick, the new Tom Cruise sequel to the 1986 film Top Gun, took in $160.5 million. $160.5 million. That's the largest Memorial Day weekend opening of any movie ever. Now, that's interesting to me because it was just a few months ago that people were talking about going to the movies being dead and that movie theaters would be closing all over the country because people just, you know, gotten out of the habit of going to the movies and people weren't comfortable going to the movies and that was just something that was over. Well, apparently not. Tom Cruise, God bless him, got people back into the movies. And I'm going to go see, I haven't seen the movie yet, but I want to see that movie. It sounds really good. It got really good reviews. Supposed to be really exciting with really great visuals. And, you know, the word is go see it in the movie theaters and go see it on the biggest screens, maybe an IMAX screen that you can go to because the visuals are just outstanding. Okay, and I'm celebrating that people are out and about and going to the movies again. I'm celebrating the fact that rock concerts are happening again. So one of my favorite modern rock groups is this group called One Republic. And I heard that they were on tour. And I haven't been to a rock concert in many, many years. But I really like One Republic because they sing about spiritual religious themes a lot. And they're just, you know, the singer is just really great. And, you know, musically, I believe they're really great. And I found out that they were coming to the San Francisco Bay Area. They're coming to the Shoreline Amphitheater in August. And I'm going. So I bought two tickets. I'm going. Reverend Peter, who's in Amsterdam, he's going with me. Yay! We're going to go see One Republic in August. I haven't been to a concert in I don't know how long. The Shoreline Amphitheater holds 22,000 people. It's a lot of people. And I just think that's great that people are out and about. You know, as the reading said, you know, people are choosing these opportunities to gladden themselves. And it's a great thing. Yesterday when I went to the office, and my office is in a different area of San Francisco, it's called the Union Street neighborhood, and a lot of traffic as I was approaching it, and then I saw that the streets were all blocked off, and then I got it. The street fair was happening. It was a Union Street fair. We haven't had a Union Street fair in 3 years because of COVID and the restrictions, but the street fair was happening. I prayed to the parking god, the parking angel. I got a parking place, And I, you know, had lots to do, and I wasn't intending to walk through the street fair, but I dropped my bags off and my stuff at the office, and I walked through the street fair, and I got a big Polish sausage hot dog, and, you know, put in relish and mustard, and I stood at a table that was right next to this really good, like, bluegrass, blues band, six-piece, you know, playing really good blues music, and I started up a conversation with the couple next to me, and they said, "That's our son playing bass over there on that band." And I said, we just chatted about that, and they were really good. I sat there and ate my hot dog and talked to these people for quite a while and just walked through the fair again. Just saw all the people, a lot of scantily clad young women were there showing off quite a bit of skin. That was kind of fun to see. I enjoyed looking at all of that. Handsome men, too. Young men, young women, older men, older women. All kinds of people were there at the street fair. Now, you know, it wasn't as big as some street fairs. Didn't have the attendance of street fairs that I've been to in the past. But it's the first year, you know. It's a start. And I am happy and I am rejoicing about that. You know, Course in Miracles says, to heal is to make happy. This was in the reading that Rudy read. I have told you before to think of how many opportunities you have to gladden yourselves and how many you have refused. This is exactly the same as telling you that you have refused to heal yourselves. So, you know, blockbuster movies and big rock concerts and street fairs, urban street fairs, and maybe even eating indoors. You know, these things aren't really important in and of themselves, but they're examples of people gladdening themselves. And to gladden yourself is to heal yourself. And to gladden yourself with the public in these large ways is a way for the public to heal. It's a way for society to heal. And it's a indication of healing. So I am really happy about that. And I think we are healing. I don't ignore the COVID pandemic. I still look at statistics. There's a great statistic website called the Worldometer, or the Worldometer, depending on how you want to pronounce that word. I think it's probably Worldometer. The Worldometer shows that COVID deaths are at an all-time low. In fact, this past week, the 7-day moving average for people passing, making their transition because of COVID in the United States is the lowest that it has been since the pandemic started in March of 2020. So, like, you know, 26, 27 months ago. So the number of people passing because of COVID is now lower than it was right at the beginning of the pandemic. I mean, that's a great thing. And again, you know, life is eternal. These things really aren't significant. The body's condition is apparently not significant, but I'm still going to rejoice and I'm still going to celebrate. I think it's a great thing. I think that it's a great thing that all of these things are happening. I am really happy that the Community Miracle Center is here, that the Community Miracle Center survived the COVID-19 pandemic. You know, a lot of churches did not, a lot of small churches especially, did not survive the COVID-19 pandemic. I was talking with John Mundy, noted A Course in Miracles teacher, about that, because he would frequently make the circuit of churches, speaking at them and speaking to them and, you know, bringing his books there. And he said just a lot of the churches that he spoke at no longer exist. You know, and actually a lot of the mitigation strategies that were instituted, you know, they had a very serious effect. They're kind of church killing strategies. You know, there is an unstated war on churches going on, and, you know, the culture wages it, And, you know, people always kind of go, when I talk about things like that. But, you know, you just think about it. During the pandemic, liquor stores were open. Marijuana stores, dispensaries were open. They were considered essential businesses. Churches, however, were not considered essential businesses, even though it was very possible for churches to allow people to come in, have them sit 6 feet apart from each other, make sure they all wore masks. That was very possible for churches. In fact, when churches were finally allowed to meet again, that is indeed what they did do. So churches could have done that, but churches were not deemed essential, while marijuana dispensaries and liquor stores were deemed essential. So just think about that. And when I say that there's a war that's gone on against church and religion in our society for many decades, actually, you know, just remember that. I think there's a lot of truth to that. Churches present an authority structure that challenges government. And government doesn't really want a competing authority structure. So I'm really grateful that the Community Miracle Center, you know, switched to Zoom right away, all our classes, all our meetings on Zoom, and our Sunday gathering on Zoom. And COVID-19 is ending. And I want people to know that Community Miracle Center has some plans in the works to go back in, start having some in-person Sunday gatherings. And we've got big plans about that because we want to make sure that when we do that, that we also have a very robust Zoom presence in our Sunday gatherings. And we're exploring a possibility and moving towards a possibility along with the help and inspiration of our own Reverend Rudy Colombini to have Sunday gatherings in his new music facility, Music City, which will have big video screens that can be in back of the speaker where the Zoom participants can be projected on the screen, and the interaction between the Zoom participants and the participants actually there in the audience can be equal. And so we call these kind of things hybrid gatherings. So the Community Miracle Center is working towards having a hybrid Sunday gathering as soon as Music City is up and running, which might be, you know, towards the end of the year or the beginning of next year. And we're also thinking about doing conferences that way. You know, we can have a conference where some people can be there in person. Those who want to, have the ability to, feel comfortable to, can be there in person. But those who want to or cannot travel can connect via Zoom. And we have hybrid conferences. So all of these things are in the plans. And I think that is terrific. You know, some people think that, you know, doesn't A Course in Miracles say that we should not have plans? But A Course in Miracles actually says the healed mind carries out the plans which it receives through listening to wisdom that is not its own. So it's not so much that we're not supposed to have plans, that we're supposed to have the plans that we get by listening to the Holy Spirit. So as I approach my birthday, you know, there's also a little bit going on about the plans that we have, that I have for the future. And it's also a little bit about a reexamination of my life and what I do and the values that I currently hold. And I have been speaking for 36 years here for the Sunday gatherings. And some people think my speaking is kind of extreme, that I take an extreme point of view about A Course in Miracles and the world not being real, and that I'm not aging and that I am youthing, and that we do not have to die and all of those things. People think those are really extreme points of views, and that, you know, maybe it'd be better off if I geared my talks at a different level. And all I can say about that is I can only give the talks that Holy Spirit is guiding me to give. I have to give the talks that Holy Spirit wants me to give and that I can connect to giving. And I connect to this totality of life and to this eternal life. And I connect to the idea of freedom. And I connect to the idea that my safety does not lie in any of these things of the world, that my safety lies in my eternal, infinite connection to the divine. Course in Miracles says, I'm in danger nowhere in the world. I'm not in danger anywhere in the world. And then it also says, love is your safety. Fear does not exist. Identify with love, and you are safe. So I have not been a big proponent of a lot of the mitigation strategies that we have done, as you know, for the COVID-19 pandemic. I think many of them did way more harm than they did good. But a lot of that is because I really identify with love. When I was in the emergency room on January 6th, I identified with love and with the guidance that love gave me, and I got out of there because I felt they were trying to kill me, and I would be safer somewhere else. And I'm so happy and grateful that I had the freedom to make those decisions. The doctors almost acted like I did not have that freedom. They were very incredulous that I just wouldn't believe them and check into the hospital and agree to be put on a ventilator and agree to be given remdesivir. They really didn't believe that I was just going to go home. But I just went home because I had that freedom and I had that guidance. And I knew that I was in danger nowhere in the world. And I knew that love was my safety and that fear does not exist. And I'm so happy that we have those freedoms. And I am aware that the freedoms that we have in our country especially are under attack. And are being challenged, and I want to stand up to be a powerful voice for those freedoms. And I've talked about this many times. You know, A Course in Miracles says that we should not fight for freedom, but we should side with it. We should always side with it. So when I re-examine the values of my life and the values going forward, I'm going to continue to side with freedom. And I'm going to continue to give that message when I'm guided to give that message. And perhaps that's not the message that people want to hear. But if it's the message the Holy Spirit wants me to give, then it will be the message that I will give. Because I give the messages that Holy Spirit guides me to give, not the messages that apparently people want to hear. A Course in Miracles says, you have heard many arguments on behalf of the freedoms, which would indeed have been freedom if man had not chosen to fight for them. The argument that underlies the defense of freedom is perfectly valid. Because it is true, it should not be fought for, but it should be sided with. So, reevaluating my life, I see right now that a big value is siding with freedom and being a voice for that. I am blessed with my own freedom. I'm grateful for it. And I think my own freedom to make my own decisions about my health care saved my body's life this year. And I am grateful for that. And I am grateful to be approaching my birthday and celebrating the eternal, infinite expression of the divine in form. That is Reverend Tony Ponticello. So, happy birthday to me, and thank you so much for listening. Woo-hoo.
Park. No, say now,
last thought. I said, love.